So I want to talk about the hero of Temesa today and his story. Let me just begin by saying that I was very keen to come to celebrate the Raven Antiquity volume. Having had such great memories of the original Cardiff Conference, and even more so, actually, of the Swansea Day School, which I think Susan and I and you, Karen, were working at earlier, must have been 1993 even. And we were squeezed together in this tiny, decrepit Egyptological museum that Swansea had at that time, on a sweltering summer afternoon, but there was a magic there. And that's why I came back. That's why I came back, rather than actually having anything useful to say about the subject of rape. So you'll see that rape is a theme in my paper, but in all honesty, it can't be called the subject of my paper. So we have three accounts of the hero of Temesa, three principal accounts of the hero of Temesa. A handout has, I hope, gone round with all the other sources as well. I'm going to be talking about two accounts in Pausanias and one in Callimachus, with just occasional references to others there. So Pausanias tells this story. So it'll be familiar to some of you. It's a good story. At Temesa, one of Odysseus's sailors gets drunk. This is on the way back to the Greek homeland after Troy. Gets drunk, rapes a local virgin, and is stoned to death by the locals. Strabo tells us that the hero in question was Polites, who's mentioned briefly in Book 10. He returns as a marauding daimon and indiscriminately kills people. The Temesans are driven to the point. I should have this on screen. Sorry, oh, that doesn't work. Okay. Again, all on your handout. The Temesans are driven to the point of abandoning Italy, but the Pythia says there is a solution. If you arrange to give the prettiest girl you have every year to the daimon, to the hero, as wife. Euthymus of Locri, Western Locri, turns up. One year, falls in love with the virgin who's about to be given to the hero, ambushes the hero, drives him from the land, whereupon he disappears into the sea. And in due course, Pausanias tells us, Euthymus himself departs from the world in an alternative way. Now, Aelian will tell us that he departed the world by disappearing into the river Caicinus. That's the story that Pausanias tells us. It's attached to his account of the statue of Euthymus, who was a boxer, Florid, early 5th century at Olympia. But he also says that aspects of this story were illustrated in a picture he saw. He doesn't tell us where he saw it. This was an Archaios painting. The word Archaios and derivatives appear 400 times in Pausanias, apparently. The scholarly investigations of his use of the term will tell us that it basically means nothing. Everything from hardcore archaic to just old, or even just like pre-Roman. So we don't know how old the painting is. Anyway, showed a young man who was called Sybaris, a river called Calabros, and a spring called Lyca. There was the demon that Euthymus cast out. His skin was awfully black, and was utterly terrifying to see. He had a wolf skin for his clothing. He was called Libas. Very interesting. Then Callimachus. This is one of the ancient summaries of the Aetia. Insofar as we can take this as an accurate summary of what Callimachus said, this is technically the oldest material. I think we can presume it's the oldest material. Anyway, it's rather different. Callimachus tells that in Temesa, a hero left behind for Odysseus' ship exacted tribute from the locals and the neighbouring peoples. They would bring along a bed and a girl of marriageable age for him, leave them, and depart without turning backwards. In the morning, her parents would take her back again. A woman instead of a virgin. That does seem, I think, plausibly Callimachean, with his attention to the domestic vignette there. You know, one imagines a sort of the atmosphere and, you know, driving home in the Ford Cortina afterwards. Now, this Callimachean passage is what has interested scholars in particular. There's an awful lot of scholarship on all this material. They're particularly interested in that. They're interested, of course, in what looks like an intimation of some sort of sacred marriage ritual or a sacred prostitution. Who knows? I think we can be fairly sure that the originating rape in the story is a rape. I'm not going to get involved in unnecessary subtleties there. Biasasthai is the word. We might hesitate over whether the giving of the girl to the hero at a later stage is a rape in any sense. Let's see some scholarship. I say there's an awful lot of scholarship. The best general starting point on all this stuff is probably Byzantine's book, which has a good general, sensible, expansive contextualization of most aspects of this story before descending into some Proppian algebra. And then probably the modern Anglo-Saxon standard would be Curry's article, INJHS there. These contributions, along with pretty much all the other contributions, attempt to splurge these three stories into one and make one sort of coherent narrative, find one sort of coherent system of thought behind it all. And I think that's wrong. And so actually the first part of my paper today is going to be to try to just separate these things rather than to splurge them together. One valuable aspect of Curry's paper is the insight that Euthymus really should be seen as a kind of river god. Of course, we've seen Aelian telling us that he disappeared into the river Caicinos, so there's a sort of an amalgamation of him there with the river. And indeed, we have these Herms from his hometown of Western Locri. They're inscribed with his name. I can't see his name in this picture, but I'm sure that it's there. And here he is in the form of a bull with a human face, which is pretty standard river god format. There's Achilleus for you. Curry also would have us believe that the hero himself, Libasrusful, is a river god. And I have to say, I think that's, he's going out on a limb there. It's a bit hard to justify that. I think the best argument for that is this comparison of Pseudo-Aeschines, and we have the text on hand there. It's a rather lovely little passage where Pseudo-Aeschines is telling us the story of the wicked Cimon and the ingenue Calliroe. Within the context of that story, I won't go into all its details, we learned that it was the custom of the virgins of Troy to wade into the river Scamander and ask the river to take their virginity from them. I'm afraid that the wicked Cimon dresses up as the river god and takes advantage. Okay, so there we go. So, differentiation one. So first of all, I want to pull apart the Pausanias' story, his narrative, from the Callimachus. You know, the point is that with the Callimachus, the girl goes home alive. Whatever other condition she's in, she's alive. I think the Pausanias story, and I don't know if you agree with me just on casual reading of it, I think the Pausanias story really does imply that she's going to die. And that's what Euthymus is going to save her from. Again, I would further this case simply by lining up these comparative narratives, which are all shown to you in a big grid on the back of your handout, if you have a handout, which looks like this. I didn't think you'd be able to read it on screen, and indeed you can't, but if you're lucky enough to have a handout, it's on the back for you there. Again, don't worry, I'm not going to grind through every little box on that handout. I think the general comparability of these narratives is self-evident. You'll all be familiar with the story of Perseus and Andromeda, of course. Ethiopia, or is it Joppa, is subject to a marauding sea monster. Again, an oracle intervenes, says you can save yourselves if you pin out Andromeda for sea monster to eat. Duly done, Perseus comes along, falls in love with Andromeda, kills sea monster, marries girl. So that's, again, I think you can see that that's a fairly similar narrative type. And again, it's pretty clear that Andromeda was heading for death, isn't it, before that. Of these others, I will just pull out, because it's relevant later too, the wonderful story in Antoninus Liberalis from Candle of Eurybatus. So here we have Delphi being subject to, again, random maraudings by a monster called Lamia and Sybaris. Delphians contemplating uprooting the city because they can't do anything about it. Again, the oracle intervenes, you'll be okay if you sacrifice a citizen lad. And so the fair Alcyoneus is pinned out for the, or put out for the monster. And Eurybatus comes along, falls in love with Alcyoneus, goes into the monster's cave, drags her out, throws her down the mountainside, she disappears at the bottom, and a spring appears in her place. So that's the sort of male version of it. So anyway, but taking all these stories together, you know, I think we do have a presumption that death is going to be the fate of the victim in those stories. So I think we are looking at something different from what Climacus is giving us. And more generally, I might make the point that those who experience sexual congress with ghosts do tend to die. Death is contagious. Well, I mean, the contact with ghosts generally is a pretty dodgy thing, but death is contagious. And so you'll be familiar with Protesilaus and Laodamia, and he's sent back for a brief spell with her. From the underworld, and then she gets suicide pretty soon afterwards. Okay, there's two logics going on there. There's the rational grief, as it were, but also there's the logic of contagion, it seems to me. Likewise, in the wonderful tale of Philinion in Phlegon and Tralles, again, a superb revenant ghost who comes back and then sleeps with the lodger. He doesn't know she's a ghost, but again, when all is revealed, he kills himself. And a kind of an interesting sort of halfway example in Xenophon of Ephesus as well, fiction within a fiction, but again the heroine Anthea tells that one night she was passing by a grave when a man leapt up out of the grave itself and grabbed hold of her and held on to her all night long, struggling to, well, do what? Take her home, I guess. But she got away, but at dawn, because he had to go back by then, but he struck her, and she developed epilepsy as a result of that. So it was almost like she was almost taken by the ghost, but not quite. And so she's almost dead, but not quite. She has a sort of the mini deaths of epilepsy as a result. Interesting text. Right. Okay. So I now want to differentiate Pausanias' narrative from Pausanias' account of the picture. And again, actually, the grid does come in here as well. But I'll show you a sort of shortened version of it. Right. So Pausanias tells us that what is in the picture? Well, the hero is there in his wolf skin. The youth Sybaris. Well, where was he in the story? The river Calabros. Where was the river Calabros in the story? The spring Lyca. Where was that? Is Euthynous there? He doesn't explicitly say so. The hero is there, the hero that Euthynous killed, but Euthynous is not said to be there. No sign of the girl. So if we exclude Euthynous and the girl from the cast list of the story implied by the picture, I think, and then we look at our table of correspondences, we get a rather different picture. Especially if we align these details with the story of Lamia Sybaris told by Antoninus Liberalis. So we have the monster, there he is in the top row, and if we look at the highlighted sort of greeny rows here, the youth, Sybaris, seemingly corresponds well to the Kouros, the Pais Alcyoneus. So in this story we've seen a young male victim, not a young female victim. Calabros is a river. Now that works well if we think that Euthymus is a river god. There's a good link there. But also, back in the Antoninus story, Eurybatus, the hero there, is the descendant of the river Axius. So there's a riverine connection there too. And then, what is the fate of our Lamia Sybaris, or she becomes a spring called Sybaris? And here in the picture, we have a spring called Lyca. So I'm wondering whether there is a sort of foreshortening of the narrative, a compression of the narrative, as often in ancient art, where we have both the hero wearing the wolf skin and the spring that he is going to become, that he's going to be transformed into by his. After his fight with the hero, the river hero. And then, of course, we have the oddity that the name Sybaris appears in both narratives, although in different contexts. Now, in case you were wondering, these are the various locations we've been talking about. Perhaps I should have shown this before. There's city of Sybaris up there. Temsa is the modern Temesa. And there's Epids appear in Locri. The river Caicinos is right on the toe of Italy, if it is. This is Talbot's atlas. He doesn't really know. He's a big question mark there. And God knows where the river Calabros is. I'm presuming it's an eponym of Calabria. But anyway, okay, so now a lot of these monsters I've been talking about in these comparative narratives are serpentine. In fact, I would say they all are. No question over the sea monster in the Andromeda story. Nor the sea monster in the Heracles and Hesione story, nice, particularly nice serpentine one there. Nor the Dracone of Thespiae, he's a Dracone, we don't have any ancient images of him, but we know what the Dracone looks like. 5 minutes, right? We know what the Dracone looks like, there he is. And I won't tell you about the Lambton worm. But what about Lamia Sybaris? No description of her in the physical description of her in the story that we're given. But Lamias in other narratives do tend to have serpentine qualities. There's a wonderful Lamia described in Statius the Baid attacking Argos, and she's an anguipede. She has the upper body of a girl, a serpentine lower half, and a snake head coming out of the top of her humanoid head, and big claws with which she skewers babies to eat. So there she is, and I'm sure that's a picture of her there, although Limp thinks it's Python, oddly. And likewise in these other sources, do go and read Dio Chrysostom, Orations 5. It will change your life. Lovely, lovely anguipede women devouring young men. And Philoctetus too, again, the famous story of Apollonius' pupil being ensnared by a Lamia who is Apollonius declares an office. She looks like a woman, but she's an office. She's a snake. So in fact, four serpentine narratives there. So we might wonder whether there's any serpentine imagery lurking in this particular narrative. Well, if Curry has his way and the hero is a river god, then of course we can observe the fact that river gods also appear in serpentine form quite often. Sometimes they're bulls, sometimes they're sort of snakes or sea serpents. That's a very famous image of Achelous in his serpentine form. But I think that's a bit of a stretch. But we might look perhaps more legitimately to the general conceptualization of returning heroes, physically returning heroes, returning in the form of snakes. So on the image at the bottom here, it's a very bit murky, but that's Amphiaraus attacking Alcmaeon, arching over the body of Eriphyle. Here we have the tomb of Patroclus, and Patroclus appears twice, first in the form of a little flying ghost with wings up top, very cute, a little mini-me sort of warrior. And here, in this sort of x-ray scene inside the tomb, in the form of a snake. So there we go, and there's lots of other literary evidence, and some of it is there for you. So we could say, He has a sort of serpentine aspect just by virtue of being a returning hero. I think there isn't going to be time. I feared there would be to talk about the lupine stuff. So what I shall do? Oh dear, how do I get into this now? I'll just click forward very quickly. It's a shame not to talk about that lovely image, isn't it? But There we go. Sorry, no time for that. It's tough, isn't it? Okay, so because I feel so guilty, I feel so guilty about not really talking about the subject of confidence, I thought I would just add this sort of self-indulgent coda, which is to ask me, so thinking about these girls, and boys for that matter, being pinned out for the monster, or being left for the monster, is devouring by the monster conceptualized as a sort of metaphorically, as a sort of rape? I think it is, in literary terms and in artistic terms as well. Now, again, the final passage on your handout is Menilius' description of Andromeda, very, very highly sexualized. And I think if we look at these Andromeda scenes in particular, she's the only one who really gets into the art in a big way. Here she is, she's being pinned out, she's in a very vulnerable, this is a sort of star map position, but she's very vulnerable, as a pinned out almost to welcome, as if welcoming a lover. And here she is, just having to hold up a dress in her teeth. I mean, why should that have to happen? You know? Again, that's a bit burlesque, but nonetheless, again, very very sort of open and vulnerable. Here too, again, it seems an especially diaphanous dress. And then we often get nude forms. I mean, I generally assume that's Andromeda. Just a little bit of a chain there to give the hint. And on we go, so more and more. And I think in reception terms, I think modern readers have probably seen, as it were, the monster's attack as a sort of sexualized thing. This is Burne Jones, and art critics aren't slow to draw attention to the phallic imagery of the sea serpent there that Perseus is bravely trying to keep away from Andromeda. And if we bear in mind this sort of, again, sort of configuration of Andromeda being pinned out between the two poles like this, one can't help thinking about King Kong, it seems to me. There's Fay Wray pinned out between her two poles in exactly the same way. And again, I think the vulnerability, the sexual vulnerability, becomes particularly apparent when King Kong himself, the super male creature, as it were, turns up and indeed falls in love with her. Doesn't he? He doesn't do what he's supposed to. He's supposed to be eating her, but actually what he does is he falls in love with her. So there's that sort of dynamic going on. There we are. And it's a powerful image. It's a powerful image which has been repeated through the other King Kong movies, as it happens. And even, actually to my chagrin, in the movie version of Perseus and Andromeda, because Ray Harryhausen is so influenced by the King Kong movie that when it was time to have Andromeda pinned out to the sea monster, he turned the sea monster from a big snake into King Kong, a rather unsatisfactory King Kong. There was a sexual curiosity was there again. Anyway, but I think those are actually quite legitimate readings of the ancient texts and the ancient art. In fact, I think there is a notion that the threatened devouring by the monster is sort of seen as analogous to